George Benjamin is one of the most eminent composers working today. His opera, Written on Skin, which was premiered in 2012, opened to rave reviews, and we are performing this work with the TSO on Saturday, March 7th. Chris Paul Harmon, many of you may know him. He is he's one of the most distinctive voices we have in Canada, and we're very pleased to be performing a brand new commission of yours tomorrow night. So, unfortunately, Hans Abrahamsen, who is the third composer that was originally going to be featured, was unable to come today because he's feeling quite ill. And he has a performance tomorrow of his work starring the great soprano Barbara Hannigan. And I hope that you can all come tomorrow because it's an astoundingly beautiful piece, and hopefully we'll get a chance to discuss it as well. So, I thought we'd just get right into it. And George, I'd like to ask you a question that will probably come up invariably today, so I thought I'd just get it into the open. You began composing at a very early age, and you studied at the Paris Conservatoire at the age of 16 with Olivier Messiaen. Can you tell us what that experience was like?
I can't really, because we won't have time. Because it was, of course, a mesmeric experience for a 16-year-old. Suddenly, still a schoolboy, to be traveling over to Paris as I did in the first year while at school, and to be sitting next to one of the great composers of the 20th century and one of the great teachers of musical history. And it was the great encounter of my life musically. And he was just an extraordinary teacher. I'm not the only person to say this, there's generations from all across the world, including Canada, who will testify to the fact that he was an amazing, devoted, inspiring, enthusiastic, subtle, liberating, inspiring teacher. He taught a huge amount. I then spent a whole year in Paris after my school days, when we would see him for about 15 hours every week. He'd come for major classes in the morning on Mondays, Thursdays and Wednesdays. God, there were days in the wrong order. And they would last about 5 hours, each one. And he would analyze his own music. He would analyze music from the past and contemporary composers that he loved. That meant then it was right up to date. So Xenakis and Boulez and Dostoevsky and Ligeti, Dutilleux, and all the great figures of his, the time then he would bring. I mean, he'd go through Debussy, Ravel, Stravinsky, sometimes Mozart, Berlioz was mentioned a lot, etc. And he would look at our pieces, and he would call me his Benjamin, which means the little one, because I was his youngest ever student, so I was a little bit spoilt, I'm afraid. But I left him when I was just 18. We stayed in contact till he died. I saw him a few months before he passed away. And it's just the most extraordinary relationship from master to pupil that I could ever imagine, and it was completely revelatory to me and fascinating. He very much encouraged his students to find their own path and to move away, and tolerated that, encouraged it. So he hated the idea of producing lots of little Messiaens, and I don't think I've become a little Messiaen, which is remaining loyal to his teaching. So in the back of my mind, really, him and his music are not much there when I'm composing now, but in my DNA, musically, I learned things that will stay with me until I write my last note. So it made a huge, huge impact on me.
That's really wonderful to hear. And it strikes me from listening to your music that you are, in fact, not one of the baby Messiaens. And in fact, it's quite difficult to trace the lineage of your music, perhaps more so than some other composers. And I wonder if this was something that you cultivated actively, the pursuit of your individual voice, or was it something that sort of came about naturally as a result of just natural processes?
Being a composer isn't a natural process. You choose a note. If you don't use microtones, there's 12 notes, but there's 8 octaves you can choose from, and then you choose the next note. And already, by the time you write your fifth note, the possibilities, in terms of sheer probabilities, are enormous. And by the time you're on page 50, it's just gigantic. So a lot of, Yeah, a lot of, at least for someone like me, an awful lot of self-reflection happens while composing, and a lot of thinking happens. Much more thinking, perhaps, than actually writing notes. And on the precise question, I never felt the desire to take part in any group or to agree with anybody musically. Not that I feel contrary or hostile to others, usually, but I do think that you have the necessity to be independent as an artist in any field. And if you've managed to find what you're made for and what works for you and what you can do, even more so than what you want, what you can do, then that will naturally lead you into, I'd almost say, fiercely independent direction. That you do what you can, you do what you want, and that's it. That doesn't mean I don't haven't and still don't study a huge amount of music, and I teach my students, and I'm try to be open and hear. I listen less to music than I used to, actually, but I've conducted a huge amount of music, contemporary and otherwise, and I'm very, very interested in what's going on. But in the end, it's not that I'm set in my ways. I constantly want to do different things and challenge myself. But at the same time, do your own thing. Find what works for you, and pursue that, I won't say ruthlessly, but really with determination and obstinacy, particularly when it doesn't work. You've got to keep on trying.
I think that's very encouraging to hear, especially with a room full of composers. And you spoke of curating music and championing the music of your peers. And I'm wondering if you can speak a little bit about our fellow composer here, Chris Paul Harmon, who is one of the Canadian composers that you found attractive. And maybe you can speak about his music, keeping in mind that he's right next to you, and then he can respond.
Well, I got to know Chris's music through our mutual friend, Un Suk Chin, the Korean composer. I have a little story to tell before I get to you, if I may, because I don't know why I'm doing this, but I'm proud of this. I was on a jury in London in 1990. No, it was at Paris, at IRCAM, and there was a distinguished jury, very distinguished jury, and we were given about 300 scores to go through, and they were anonymous. And I found this one score that I really liked. And I thought it was really remarkable, probably the best score I'd ever seen in any competition, a jury that I've been on. And I didn't know who it was by, I didn't know the sex of the composer, I didn't know where he or she was, but I just thought this was wonderful. And as often happens on juries, people don't agree, and we couldn't give her the top prize. I managed to get her still in the list of composers who received a small commission, but I thought this piece was so good. I shouldn't be answering. This is not the way to answer. But anyway, I thought it was so good that I took it to London and I performed it and discovered it. And this was a big break for Un Suk. The next day she found her publisher, Boosey and Hawkes. And now she's an immensely prominent and hugely and rightfully successful composer. And I heard of Chris through her quite a long time ago. When did you first meet Un Suk?
About 10 years ago.
Oh, I thought it was longer than that. And she sent me... Or did you send me some CDs that I'd asked for?
We both sent something.
Okay, yeah, I got some stuff and I listened to it. And with great pleasure, and I played it to some of my own students who were interested, fascinated. And you had a concert in London about 3 or 4 months ago.
Last year.
Yeah, which unfortunately I couldn't come to because I was shut away composing very hard. But when there was a possibility for me to conduct a premiere here by a Canadian composer, there are several that I know and admire, but I chose Chris. And what I like about his music, and I like about this piece that we're doing tomorrow, well, it's his independence. It's your music inhabits a strange zone, and I like strange, and it's a very individual sensibility. And it has charm for the ear. It's completely unpretentious, but it has a sort of poetics that's of its own and touching and strange. So, I'm very, very happy to be doing it.
Chris, so maybe you can talk a little bit about your music for tomorrow. And I should add to George's comment that I find that with your music, I don't have to listen to you know, more than a few seconds before I know that it's you. You have a really distinctive voice. And so maybe can you talk about Lieder und Arien?
Thank you. Well, the title Lieder und Arien in German vernacular simply means songs and arias. If you wanted to pursue the topic in more detail, you would find that in the German language, both terminologies have many different meanings that can be traced throughout the last 500 or so years of Western classical music history. But in this sense, what I'm referring to is a collection of chorale melodies and figured basses that were published first as an appendix to Bach's 371 harmonized chorales. The edition I used is from the 20th century, the Riemenschneider edition. And one of the things that interests me in creating a work in finding source material is to try to strike a balance between homogeneity and heterogeneity of material. So in this collection of chorale melodies, there are certain features that are similar from one to the next, but differences as well, sometimes with contour or mode. So my goal was to fashion a work of homogeneity from a somewhat diverse pool of source material. The sense, the broader sense of the meaning of the terms Lieder und Arien, I think is borne out in the processes with which I treat the material. I use techniques, chromaticisms that are common to the 19th or 20th centuries, but I also use much older techniques. I sometimes manipulate medieval rhythmic modes in patterns that are uncharacteristic of medieval music. There are some personal references as well. I have a colleague at McGill University, Peter Schubert. His name is Peter Schubert, interestingly enough, who's written two treatises on counterpoint. So one of my treatments of one of the chorale melodies was to simply create a second species counterpoint exercise. But then all of this, another dimension, comes to life through the orchestration. And the orchestration, of course, does not observe the rules of orchestration of Renaissance or Baroque music, and even the rules of 19th or 20th century classical music are sometimes inverted as well. If we consider which instruments normally are privileged, strings, then woodwinds, maybe brass. In my work, the percussion and some supplementary keyboards and harps form the crux of the instrumentation, and then the standard orchestral instruments typically provide a secondary role. I hope that I tried to put all of that in a nutshell.
Yeah, no, that's great. The orchestration of your work is one of the most distinctive features I find in your music, and you definitely favor the harps, and there's also a prepared piano as well. One aspect of your music that I've noticed is that each time one of these variations on the chorales comes to a close, there's a kind of long pause, there's a fermata, and it has the effect of fracturing the discourse a little bit. Is that something that you're deliberately going for?
I'm very interested in discontinuous musical flow. There were times in the past when I was interested in much more fragmented forms. I wrote a piece for flute and piano called 30 Scarlatti Sketches that lasted 3 minutes and had 30 sections in it, and each was separated by a grand pause. Not so grand in that context. But since then, I've tried to take a conciliatory approach to create music that has a flow, but which shows nonetheless distinct juncture points, and continuity may obtain abstractly. For example, although I may use different pitch materials in section A versus section B, there may be some commonality of register or instrumentation or rhythm. So I try to achieve continuity in more imperceptible ways, as opposed to tracing a clear and indelible line from the start to the finish.
With a discourse that's as long and dramatic as the opera form, such as written on skin, how do you deal with the problem? Actually, perhaps maybe we should talk about the context of that opera first. Can you give us a little bit of a summation of Written on Skin?
The story?
Sure, yeah.
I'd like to get to the other question, just of discourse, if we could.
Yeah, sure.
Because you've raised a very interesting issue there, I think. The opera is set mainly in the 13th century, retelling an Occitan Provençal story, a terrible story, which is brought to life with the help of, we call them, Martin Crimp, my colleague and I, 21st century angels, modern magical people who bring this old story to life. And the story concerns, the original title of the story was Le Coeur Mangé, The Eaten Heart. And it's a story which is fairly gruesome, very briefly told. A very wealthy landowner invites an illuminator into his house to make the most beautiful imaginable book, illustrated manuscript, in his honor. While working in his castle, the wife, who's very downtrodden and can't read, can't write, is treated rather badly, as all wives were apparently in 13th century France, she begins to become interested in the illuminator. An affair starts, the protector gets to hear of it, told in the shortest way possible. The protector finds out about the affair. In fact, he's told it by the illuminator, intentionally. He murders the illuminator and feeds the heart to his wife, who shows at the last moment the ultimate sort of victory, if you like, by defying a husband, by saying, and this is in the original French story, nothing will ever take the taste of that heart out of my mouth. It's the best thing I've ever tasted. And he runs at her with a blade, and she, again, an absolute taboo for the 13th century, she throws herself out of a balcony and kills herself. So it's quite a very simple love triangle and a very simple ancient story. It's true. My feeling is, at least from my point of view, is that if you're filling an opera with a story lasting an hour and a half, there has to be a degree of tension, indeed cumulative tension and continuous tension across the fabric. And my ideal would be that an audience member who hopefully might be submerged in the world of the piece and may be taken by it feels an unbroken arc from almost the first bar to the last one. That would be my hope. You can't compose like that. It's not possible, even if you were Bach or Mozart. It's not possible. You need changes. You need contrast. You need your ear has to be refreshed. Technique and tempo and harmonic direction, harmonic motion, all the aspects of music need continual reevaluation to maintain interest, to maintain, I'd say, charm, and to maintain dramatic tension. Therefore, it's essential to stop, and it's essential to change technique. Sometimes you mutate techniques, sometimes you superimpose them, at other times you cut them. And indeed, there are 15 scenes in my work, quite short scenes, and they all tend to have a specific technique. But my cuts, you can perceive them mostly, but at the same time, you're meant to feel an arrow through them, which isn't the case, I don't think, in your piece, at least not in the same way. And I think what's, in a quite extreme point of view, which is rare amongst composers today, it seems to me you're treating an obsession of composers since a sort of vernacular fell apart at the beginning of the 20th century, which is organicism. Composers tend to treat organicism often, at least in the post-war period, as a homogeneity of technique, serialism, or a homogeneity of process, completely joined up lines, like you get in minimalism, and like you also get in spectral music, and also you get in a lot of post-serial music. And you are treating organicism as a collage artist might do, which is treating it as a collection of objects, which in a way don't have huge amount of connections between them, but share a sort of definition. Is that fair?
That's fair. What should I add to that? Well, thank you for that assessment. I would say that I'm also concerned with the idea of syntax, even within sections. As I mentioned before, there are elements of very old music in particularly in my pitch language now. One can readily hear diatonic or modal scales triads, cadences. But my idea is to reformulate the syntax in which they fit together. So as regards the larger scale form, I think the choice of materials from one section to the next contributes to this idea of a section as a sound object. But in this particular case, the prevalence of melody is so strong that I suspect that there may be more of a line than one might think at first. I'll have to wait and see.
Thank you, Chris. You brought up a point about referencing diatonic scales and modes and so forth. And I have a question for both of you that I would hesitate to ask, but I'm also too curious to not ask, which is, what do you see the relationship for both of you with the tonal tradition, and where do you see that sort of leading? And maybe you can speak on that for a bit.
That's a huge question.
Sorry.
Since I was a child writing music, there isn't such a thing as a priority in composing. Most things you have to function at some point or other in a piece. But there's an overriding obsession for me, which is harmony. And this became an all the more stronger obsession with mine because when I was a student in Paris in the 70s, it was the last topic on a lot of composers' list. And harmony was relegated to either a negative purpose or as a means of coordination, theoretical or otherwise, but not treated as something of where the life of the music started. This wasn't the case with Messiaen, and that was our first really close port of contact, because generations of his students had been rather caustic about his harmony, which is so wonderful and so original. And I think he was interested in the right word, but he was touched that there was someone from a youngest generation from his point of view, who was really, really interested in harmony. So, I think maybe for the generation before, tonality was a real, really problematic word. I don't really have a problem with it. I'm not scared of consonants. I'm not scared of any musical ingredient. As long as it's in the right place and it's integrated and combined with the basic language, the overall language of a piece. My music doesn't have cadences. The bass is not functional. You'd find it very difficult to find any form of figured bass or the relevant or the which is actually at the heart of tonality in what I do. On the other hand, there are pitches and types of harmony which attract, I'm thinking of this piece written on Skin I'm Conducting on Saturday, across the score and have a magnetic pull to them, but not in a way that is traditionally tonal. Also, I am extremely interested in polyharmony, in types of harmony, two or three or seven types, which each have a certain degree of integrity by themselves, but which also fuse into one harmony when heard simultaneously. And here I disagree a little bit with my teacher, who loved to superimpose things and kept them just apart by giving them different harmonic colors. I like to superimpose things, but I like equally to control the harmonic motion and to keep things moving. That the great argument I have with serial music is that it's, as Messiaen himself said, it's harmonically grey. Constant reiteration of the 12 pitches chromatically. Eventually, it's suffocating. Great music is an extraordinary technique. Great things have been achieved through it and after it. But harmonically, there's a real problem there. One of the solutions that solved that, the major one, was the invention by firstly Webern, but then Boulez and Berio, of harmonic fields, static pitch, 12-note chords, in which the music sort of floats and exists, but I find that too static. I don't think it creates tension, and it also creates tremendous problems for polyphony, because everything becomes arpeggiation, and you make lines not out of a succession of harmonic tones, but out of a melodic impetus in which every pitch cannot be harmonic. So if I'm trying to answer you quickly, my answer is I can't. I think the terminology is problematic. I think there's very little music that is genuinely atonal, and that there's music which isn't tonal, but isn't atonal otherwise. And I think it's far too simplistic. So I'd say I pass, because my music isn't, in the end, it's not relevant.
I think far too simplistic is a perfect answer for that. Chris, do you have any thoughts?
Sure. I would like to comment on a piece of Mr. Benjamin's that I've listened to many times. It's called Dance Figures. It's an orchestra piece. I believe it's an orchestration of piano music. And it's interesting, Mr. Benjamin has just insisted that there are no functional bass notes or diatonic scale degree tones in his music. But sorry, maybe I misquoted.
Not scale diatonic.
Okay. One of the interesting things that I find about the second movement of that, speaking of layers of polyharmony, there is a melody, as I recall, that is carried as a kind of a harmonic spectrum, a little bit like blending organ tones together. And then there is a bass line, as I recall, that is carried by the strings, and I can remember distinctly these progressions of perfect fourths. And I remember remarking how strong the tonal suggestiveness was without ever resolutely establishing a tonal center. And I wanted to say that this kind of flirtation with the vocabulary of tonal music is something that I find very interesting, because I think it is completely related to music of our time. In a very general sense, I would like to say that I like music with pitches. I too like harmony very much. The only kind of music that I don't very much like looking at of my students when they come to see me is when the music is completely noise-based. And the specificity of the sounds that they are calling for are such that I could never create even a remotely remote approximation of the sound of their score, because it consists solely of variations of white noise. But again, I don't think diatonicism, tonal music is a liability in any way. And I think even Ligeti said this in the 1960s, when he said, why chromatics? Without even meaning 12-tone music specifically, why chromatics? Why do we have to saturate the chromatic spectrum of our music? And so in some of his works in the early 1970s, tetrachords, diatonic tetrachords, become the core of the pitch material for large sections of his works. So I don't have a preference for one type of pitch language over another. I had mentioned the idea of syntax before. I'm very interested in the work of composers who reimagine or reconfigure the syntax of their music, whatever their pitch materials may be.
I could go on and continue asking questions along this line, because it's so interesting. I'm going to pull it back a little bit and just ask you a final question from up here, and then maybe we can open it up for the audience. If any of you have any questions, just maybe formulate something and feel free to ask. What is the greatest challenge for you as a composer?
To write better music. Permanently, that's the challenge, till you stop writing. I just finished a piece a month ago, and I'm about to start another big piece in a few weeks' time. So I'm in the middle of that nice brief period when you're free from such huge questions. I'm not going to say what there are, but there's some things I'd like to do, lots of things I'd like to do, that I haven't yet found a way of doing them. And that's a big challenge, but probably that's what one should attack with the next piece and the piece after, because if you can do something, you can do it, we feel you can do it well, that could well become boring. I think the job of a composer, not a job, at least for me, myself, I like to search, and I like to do things I can't do, and to try and, because when you discover something, there's a sort of freshness in the air which is invigorating while you're working. And I hate routine. I hate routine. So to solve some of the things I can't do, that would be probably what I'd reply.
I find self-doubt a real issue with composing. I constantly ask myself, what I'm doing now, is this what I should be doing? I find it very unsettling, and I think there is no way around it except through it. It's not always like that, but even now, I guess I've been composing for about 30 years, and I'm still faced with some of the same kinds of almost childlike fears about, is this really what I should be doing? If I do this, does this fit with this? Should I be going in a different path? I find that the most difficult part. But at any given moment, when I compose, when I try to work out local problems, that's the most enjoyable part for me, the puzzles, the games of it. So it's not all difficult. You might want to ask Mr. Benjamin, what is the easiest part of composing?
I don't think there is one, I'm afraid. It's an empty page is a very frightening thing. And to do everything that you want in a piece of music, and as it were, to be truthful to the material you're setting up and your vision for eventually when it becomes clear what a piece is, it's almost impossible. And every day when I wake up writing a piece, I do think I'm not going to be able to write the next bar, and then I might write it perhaps, or a few days later, and then comes the next problem. Some people are fluent. I'm by nature a fluent musician. I could improvise for hours in front of you, and but it's not. I don't compose fluently, and in a way, I'm probably wrong about, very wrong about this. But I might be a little bit suspicious. I think today the situation artistically, stylistically is such that there's many different directions to take, no one huge direction to take. And you have to, therefore, you're more isolated and freer as an artist. And that freedom is wonderful. Not to be forced to follow this or that, but to do what you really want. But at the same time, it's terrible. It's terrible to find your general stylistic direction, and it's terrible when you're finding the single note, because the only thing that you have to guide you is your conscience and your imagination. And so, yeah, I guess it's lonelier than in some ways than it was at different eras. But equally, the freedom is a wonderful thing. So I wouldn't give it up. But it just requires Ravel says, it's very simple. Composing is choice. You make a choice. You put a dynamic there. You put a slur there. You write a note there, a chord. You make a choice about the tempo, whatever. And just those choices are gigantic now and are hard to make. But why should it not be hard? On the contrary, it should be hard. What we do as artists and present them to people, have them play by musician, that should cause us trouble. It should be a challenge for us to make something which fills people's time to listen to. And I like the idea of art being very difficult and, being something that's almost impossible to do, not necessarily to play.
Well, thank you so much. I think we'll take a bit of time now and just, are there any questions from you guys? Okay, I just saw one there, and I'll pass off the mic to Mike.
Hello. My question is for Mr. Benjamin. You spoke of the harmonic world of a piece, and I was wondering if you could compare perhaps the harmonic worlds of two pieces of yours that I'm very fond of, Into the Little Hill and Written on Skin. And with regards to the harmonic world of each piece, I'm wondering if you could say something about how the size of the two works, both the size of the ensemble, the smaller one for the first opera and the rather large ensemble for Written on Skin, and also the size of the work itself in terms of the length, influenced or shaped the harmonic world of the piece in terms of tessitura, spacing, density, and also long-term harmonic planning? Maybe that's a bit too complicated.
It's a very interesting question, thank you. Okay, the scale of the piece in terms of the number of players for Into the Little Hill is 15 players and two singers. Written on Skin is four times bigger, 60 musicians, a full orchestra, and five singers. Vertically, when you've got so many musicians, you're going to have to think up more strands and more complex harmonies at certain points. In terms of length, in terms of the horizontal aspect, you have to have fast and slow music in a piece, but the scale of your harmonic thinking has to change according to, yes, the scale of the piece, of course. One thing that's fascinating about writing a piece that lasts more than an hour, and this is my first, is that you can refer to and remember things that happened an hour ago and bring them back when the ear of the listener has almost forgotten them, if not totally forgotten them. And that's a very beautiful thing, to have strands moving backwards and forth across a huge scale. It's like the difference between writing a piece in a pond and writing a piece in a great big lake. You have the landscape is much, much bigger. One thing I'll say is very important: harmonic motion. Everything in a piece of music has rhythm. Not just the rhythms that people play, but there's rhythms in a vast number of different levels. There's the rhythms of intellectual aspects, thematic aspects, polyphonic aspects. There's a rhythm of colors, there's a rhythm of textures, there's a rhythm of activity. Every single thing you use in a medium or to a long term has a sense of rhythm. And planning the harmonic rhythm of a piece of music on a huge scale is firstly, it's a subliminal thing. No one comes out of an opera and says, gosh, a little member of the public, what a nice, I really enjoy the harmonic rhythm of the piece. But if you don't think about that one really as a big priority, the tension, the curve of the tension, or the different degrees of tension simultaneously won't work. People will get bored as well. And so on a big scale, I'd say you have to stand back a lot and imagine from afar what the whole piece as it's forming looks like, and see the curves through time of the harmonic rhythm creates. Sometimes you need to move fast, other times you have to be almost static. At times when you're static, the music can be very still. At times when you're static, the music can be very fast. So I don't think I'm necessarily answering your question, but I will say one other thing, which is harmonic rhythm depends on things moving. Something which wasn't there comes there. Something which isn't there now is not going to be there next. In other words, it's as much about absence as about presence. And that's not only an element of tessitura and register and timbre, which is related to those. It's to do with density, it's to do with speed, but it's also to do with pitches. And particularly when you're working specific pitches, pitch classes, when you're dealing with singers, who tend to, I believe in an opera, have to dominate the ear, and that means the middle range of the music is the most important. The bass is obviously very important, occasionally the extreme heights, absolutely essential, but it's the middle where the voices are singing and need support from the orchestra, need harmonic support. Referring, as we did, back to serialism, I'm really conscious in a given bar or a given beat what pitches are not being used. And that might mean that a certain pitch might be missing for a very long time. And equally, that a certain specific pitch in a certain octave, like the soprano's top C, that is positioned across a piece in specific formal points. One at the beginning, absolutely the very end, two climactic points in the second and third act, and very little elsewhere. And that would be my attitude across the piece to every pitch that I have, that has a rhythm. So I'm not answering your question necessarily, but it's quite a complicated question to answer.
I think this only needs a brief answer, but I notice you do have that high C at the very end of Written on Skin in the strings, I believe. What motivates pitch aside from, well, what motivates that pitch?
Okay, top C's. Barbara Hannigan. She has a lovely one. The last note you hear of the second act, when she decides that she challenges the Illuminator to break her husband, to destroy him, by writing a letter describing what's been happening between them. The last word she says, make him cry blood. Blood, good vowel, open mouth, good for high note. It's a climactic point. She's mad with jealousy and rage. Yeah, time to pull out the top C. Sorry. and it's unaccompanied. The orchestra cuts off virulently and she's left hanging there. Equally, her last word of the opera, when she throws herself off the parapet, is this heart. Is it mouth? I think it's mouth. Mouth. Mow. Again, good vowel. A very, very sensitive and very generous librettist who helps me with my syllables. That's the other time. The only two times she sings it. That is mirrored right at the very beginning of the piece, at the end of the first scene, very quietly in the violins. You will almost miss it. It also dominates the... It actually dominates... excuse me, I just remember. There's an interlude when the boy is murdered, the Illuminator is murdered, the climax of which happens to be, not by accident, the top C. And that note, 15 minutes from the end, is rarely absent, though the harmony is constantly changing and constantly changing colour and everything else. But that note begins to obsess the harmonic fabric of the piece, and it's true, the piece ends with it. So there's a rhythm to that. It's a note which isn't used at all frequently, except at the very beginning of the introduction, and then begins to take the piece over towards the end. And I suppose it has a symbolic importance to me while I was writing.
Any other questions? Yes.
Thank you. Well, Mr. Benjamin, you spoke of the nearly frighteningly limitless amount of options that a modern composer has when making choices. And I've heard a lot of different composers talk about setting their own artificial parameters on a project before they start, or their own constraints of how they choose to work on something. And I was wondering if you think that there is another way of approaching a project, or if that is essentially how all projects begin, is by trying to keep within one type of framework.
Rules, laws, in which you reduce the terrain, and then in which you can play, like a child playing with bricks on the floor. That is one of the most fascinating ways of composing. My attitude would be very simple. When the perspective of the music is simple, and maybe the emotions in an opera are simple, I don't need architecture, I don't need scaffolding to help me. My instinct can be, as it were, a little bit freer, and the context of the music can, as it were, like a snowball falling down a hill, it can begin to, as not compose itself, but doesn't need a degree of hidden abstraction behind the music. But the moment you get into complex continuity, where several strands will coexist, where things mutate, where things collide, where things superimpose, the intuition can't really cope with that. And then you need help. And then you need help through construction. And this is something who used to think of music as a very intuitive way against the serial thought. I've learned a lot in the last decades. And my music is really, I don't want it to sound it, but it's very constructed. And there's passages where there's an awful lot of work which has gone on under the music, which you can't perceive, but without which the music wouldn't have been possible. That the 19th century, 18th century composers didn't have to do this. Firstly, they had a vernacular. But I've thought a lot about this. And I think one of the reasons they didn't have to do this, apart from their codified harmonic ingredients, was thematicism. Because if they concentrated on the profile, the ingredients, the intervallic cells, the rhythmic incidents within a theme, that gave you material to which you could spread across your canvas. I personally can't find a way, I don't even if I want to, which works with thematic material in terms of themes that I can find acceptable to myself. And that's what's interesting with what you're doing in your piece, because you really are, firstly, you're working with thematic material from the start, and secondly, you're using found material, just like Debussy would use folk songs, the Russian composer would use folk songs. And this is very pretty rare in the last 100 years. What led you to that? And is what I'm talking about, I mean, I get really, really angry with the amount of pre-construction really required, because you get blocked and it doesn't work. It's too stiff, and then you can't work with it, and then it's too loose, and then it doesn't work. And it takes a long time to go all the nuts and bolts in place. I can compose now. Did you turn to thematism because of such a thing, or is this foreign territory to you?
Perhaps in the early 1990s, I was first a quasi-spectral composer and then a quasi-serial composer. And it was actually through a friend and colleague of mine, James Rolfe, who worked in a very, I can't think of the right word, a very harsh, a very severe way with deconstructing different kinds of music, that I decided to try to take this on in my own music, and it has persisted ever since. And for me, one of the reasons of doing it, I will turn back and forth since the question originated over here. There is for me a give and take between following and adhering to something that is found, that is in front of me. That gives me some framework to work within. It provides some guidelines. Musical material often contains the seeds for its own development. But at the same time, I'm also open to certain flights of fancy. Mr. Benjamin and I had I think you asked me earlier, are there musical moments or objects that end up on the cutting room floor? And that's very much the case. I personally like music that exhibits a high degree of order and pre-planning, whether or not one can detect it, as Mr. Benjamin said, it sometimes exists below the audible surface. But at the same time, I also like music that surprises me, that behaves uncharacteristically. So I think both approaches can be integrated.
Stravinsky is the great user of found material, isn't he? And Messiaen in a different way. Are there either composer on your radar?
Do I have to be honest?
Yes.
Yes, very much so. I think I've probably listened to Sacre du Printemps several hundred times and studied the score carefully. Messiaen's music I've listened to a lot, but I haven't studied it as carefully as Stravinsky. But I don't know if I agree that Stravinsky is the great borrower. He was a prodigious borrower, and I think he even came into legal trouble for doing so in Petrushka. But I think borrowing is inevitable. Chants become polyphony. Polyphony becomes sacred music. It seems from one era to the next, there is some type of transfer of music. So I choose to consciously make it a part of my approach. I believe that if I choose not to, I will end up doing it anyway. So I would rather make a more concerted effort to choose what I choose to borrow.
This is probably a question for both people, but it does reference a comment that Mr. Benjamin made about thinking versus writing, and as a composer who also thinks an incredible amount about before I write even a note on the page, I'm very interested in kind of maybe getting a glimpse into into what are some of the thoughts in both of your heads before writing a piece?
Mr. Benjamin strikes me as a bit more of a sober-minded thinker than myself. I tend to throw myself into things initially because really there's nothing to lose at the beginning. Rather, the more that is put on the page, then I feel that the stakes get higher. Your turn.
You know, the thing is to find what works for you, what you can do, what works for you. There's limitless ways of starting anything creatively. Some people find one note, literally one note. Harrison Birtwistle starts many pieces with the note E, a very great compatriot of mine. Other composers will start from a chord. Boulez has started many pieces from a chord. Dutilleux also, I think, also. Messiaen will go looking for bird songs, and then he'd try to evoke a landscape, etc. A series made out of people's names, not a series, a five-note group of notes with someone's five letters, a personal thing, a formal idea, a texture. I mean, there's just anything. For myself, my answer, I suppose, is I just don't know. I'm suspicious if there's a way of starting pieces. I think it's right that you should. The thing is, I think each piece is, in a way, a search for something fresh to say and something authentic inside to find, to speak, to sing authentically from inside as a composer, talking metaphorically. And it's maybe better you don't know what you want to sing, and that you discover it. If you know what you want to sing, and then you fill it with notes, then you're going to, as it were, confirm what you know about yourself and confirm what type of expression you want to have. I'd like to concentrate myself on nuts and bolts. I'm fascinated by pitches and rhythms and form. It's just enough for 100 lives. It's so interesting. And the expressive aspect, I'll let that evolve and let that grow and just see what I find when I play. Play, I think that's an important thing. Playing around with things. Now, if you're very fussy like I am, excessively fussy about detail, then, yeah, it takes a bit of time to get going. That means a few months, usually. And that's not a particularly nice process. I'd much rather just write lots and then take... And I'd encourage people to take your point of view, not mine. You have to put up with who you are and what you are and what you can do. And I have to wait till I find something that just I know how to use it, and I have no idea what it can become. And that will get me interested. And if I'm interested, then the piece will grow. And along the way, vague ideas of formal shape, a general tone, a general relationship between different types of material, a sort of continuity, how things connect, how they cut, how they blend, a type of melodic writing, a type of harmonic tone, all sorts of things will be little vague lost ideas, and gradually they will coalesce into something eventually, hopefully. And then you get a piece, and when you finish the piece, you think, well, I always intended that. That's my piece, but it's not like that. It's confusion, basically. Except confusion, I'd say.
So we have time for, I believe, one more question. Is there anybody? Yes.
If you don't mind, there's a piece that hasn't been touched on, which is this piano work tomorrow night. Or is it tomorrow? Yes. I'd just be interested to know the background to that piece.
Yeah, that was one of my real problems, that piece. It was extremely hard to write because... Have you ever written a piano concerto?
Something like one.
Yeah, this is something like one too. I don't know about you, I found it monstrously hard because I find the simultaneity of piano and orchestral instruments, really difficult to accept. I don't know how the Romantic composers accepted some of the things they did.
I think we're out of time, so I'd like to thank you both so much for your time. I know that we really appreciate hearing your thoughts and your insights. And if you have a chance, please come to the concert tomorrow, which will feature George Benjamin's duet, Christoph Hartmann's Lieder und Arien and the aforementioned Hans Abrahamson work. And if you can, on Saturday, Written on Skin, it'll just be spectacular. I guarantee you'll enjoy it. So thank you so much.